It's been 1 year since coronavirus shutdowns upended and transformed our lives. And as we inch closer to reopening, we're all wondering what comes next and looking at emerging trends and themes that will change how we live and work in a post-COVID world. And joining me to talk about all this is Amy Webb. She's a futurist and founder of the Future Today Institute, which recently released its highly anticipated annual Tech Trends Report. So Amy, I just really want to underline for our viewers here, what a year we had, because you usually release one report. This year it was 12. What was your big takeaway from 2020?
Our big takeaway is that I never want to go through a year like that ever again, for many reasons. So the trends that we track are longitudinal, and they are derived from qualitative and quantitative data. And the bottom line is that in the year 2020, the game board got reset, all the pieces flew up into the air, and we had to rearrange things. That alone resulted in hundreds of new signals. And as we built our models, it was clear that we were dealing with many new trends that we had not seen before. So that resulted in a 22% increase in the normal number of trends that we follow. But this is a strong signal for businesses as well. The vaccines may be here, but there is a lot of work ahead.
Yeah, and you talk a little bit about some of these big clusters that you're focusing on. One of this is what you're calling a new world disorder, which a lot of, you know, growth investors are kind of aware of some of these trends with genomics, crypto, a lot of decentralization happening in this area. So what are some of those things that you're seeing that businesses need to do to adjust to this new world?
So one of the interesting things that we tracked, especially toward the end of 2020, was that there were new disruptors in places where traditional regulators would be there watching and sort of influencing what was happening. And that was true in the crazy market volatility with GameStop trading, as well as some crazy things happening in the crypto market, places where we would have expected regulators to step in when there was true political unrest. It didn't happen. Instead, we saw the emergence of what we're calling a CDOS. This is a corporate denial of service versus a DDoS, a distributed denial of service. What wound up happening was that companies, rather than our institutions, made decisions about whether to allow somebody to stay online, whether to allow trading to continue. And for investors, I think this starts to change the calculus a little bit. Because if it's companies that are stepping in versus institutions, then the question is, who are you answering to? And really, who are you following and tracking?
Right. And, you know, we've seen such a growth in sort of this, what they call ESG investing or socially conscious investing. And I feel like that might be an area also ripe for growth as well as we kind of move forward.
So it's interesting you brought up ESGs. One of the trends that we're tracking is the intersection of ESGs and artificial intelligence. One of the problems with ESGs is it's hard to track some of the intangible data to prove that a company is doing what it needs to. So really, in the AI book, there's a super interesting use case on how natural language processing is being used to make sense of ESG data so that companies can prove to their investors that they're actually making good on those ESG goals and promises.
That is a really exciting development because, yes, I've heard this constantly in the ESG space that, you know, some of these things are super hard to measure. And I want to kind of pivot a little bit to another area that you're looking at that we've seen a huge acceleration with, this idea of connectivity. And we know about the Internet of Things, you know, there's smart chips being put in all of our products, but now you're looking at the U of things, things actually being put into ourselves. Can you talk a little bit about that trend space and what you're seeing there?
So in 2018, one of our key takeaways from that year's report was that smartphones were on their way out. That makes sense. There's not a lot of new features. There's only so much compute you can put into those devices. And consumers are looking for other features in other places. So what's happening is a new constellation of devices that surround us, that we wear, and pretty soon that we ingest. So we're moving away from the Internet of Things to the U of Things, where your personal data are continuously being mined, refined, and scraped for a whole variety of purposes. But you know, you connect to the device connects to the cloud, and ultimately to companies. There's a lot of wonderful opportunity in there. This is also a potential risk space for businesses.
No, absolutely. And I, you know, when you mentioned that, and, you know, I think back to when Elon Musk tweeted about, you know, getting a Neuralink implant, but I think a lot of people, at least myself, I want to know where this data is going and who's securing it. I feel like there may be, one of the offshoots of this is really, you know, cloud and software security as we become more connected.
That's a wonderful point. Investors don't ask the question of the companies that they're investing in or the boards that they sit on, what is your data governance and what does your data hygiene look like? I know that data governance is not a sexy, exciting topic. I know that it's outside the understanding of a lot of people, but the truth is COVID forced millions of people to suddenly work from home and businesses were not ready. They hadn't gone through a digital transformation, which means that all of these devices and all of these platforms weren't necessarily secured or using encryption that makes sense. It makes us vulnerable. So businesses need to get smart fast, and they need to start having serious conversations about what that data ecosystem looks like. But investors, this is on you too. You have to take time and thought in asking, what is data governance within that company that you're invested in? What does the data hygiene look like? And what are the policies that are being enforced?
Right, and you know, you talked about this digital transformation, and one area that we've seen that, especially over the last year, is in healthcare. And I know you talked a little bit about, you know, some of the tension coming into this space as we do move to a more connected, implants in our bodies, wearables, you know, that data being transmitted. What do you see big tech's role in the healthcare space maybe looking like?
I think big tech thinks that it has a very big role to play. And in fact, it's already moving in pretty aggressively. In the United States, a lot of the diagnostic testing, a lot of the requirements of healthcare have been off-prem. So outside of our homes and our offices and in a brick and mortar. But the reality is that diagnostic tests were already on their way and COVID accelerated that. So a lot of what we feature in the trend report in that section are all of the different ways that healthcare has changed. Because we can take tests anywhere, we can gather our own data, we can make choices and decisions. Now comes the big tech companies. COVID was great for them. And in the past 12 months, their healthcare ambitions are starting to be realized to some extent because of the virus. So one of the most interesting use cases has to do with Amazon. Most people have no idea just how heavily invested Amazon is in all of the different components of healthcare. And just recently, Amazon announced that it's taking its Amazon Care program to all 50 states. There are profound implications here. One is that healthcare in the United States is going to look very, very different over the next decade. I know that seems implausible, given that we've gone through 20 years of legislators trying to change healthcare policy and basically, you know, keep winding back up at the same spot. But we've got outsiders coming in now with the golden ticket, and that golden ticket is our data, and that changes everything.
No, that's so interesting. And as you said, we've seen Amazon making tons of moves and acquisitions in that space. And, you know, I just want to quickly wrap up because what I appreciate about your work is, you know, you always make sort of these projections. But as you say, you know, we can't really predict the future. Our founder, Bill O'Neill, you know, always said that about the market as well. You can't predict the market. You can only read the signals. So where can people go to access your report?
That's right. Don't worry about predictions. Focus on preparation. That's the single best thing that you can do to ensure you have a great future. You can go to futuretodayinstitute.com and all of our data, all of our reports, everything trend related is available for free. All of our work is open source and you can download it now.
Yes, and it's such a great resource. And I love too that you also identify specific companies and individuals that are really moving things in these spaces. So thank you so much for your insights today.
Thank you. One last thing, if I can. Those companies in this year's report, we did something different. These are mostly companies that you will not have heard of before. And we're not endorsing them, but we are recommending that you take a look. So these are not the usual suspects that you're going to find in this year's report.
No, that's great, because we have a bunch of growth investors here. So they're always looking for the next emerging name. So Amy, thank you again so much today for your time.
Thank you.
And for more of our tech trends coverage, you can head on over to investors.com. For Investors Business Daily, I'm Alexis Garcia.
Hey everyone, thanks so much for watching Investors Business Daily on YouTube. If you want to watch more videos, make sure you hit that subscribe button so you don't miss a thing.